Jesus. So
Ministries. My name is Carl Taylor. It's my beautiful, wonderful, lovely wife, Charity Taylor. Praise God. We've been married 32 wonderful years, right?
Amen.
Glory to God. And it gets better and better and better and better.
Amen.
You know, wine, you know, not that we're wine drinkers, okay? But wine is better, you know, over a period of time. When you go to a restaurant or something like that, you hear people talking about, you know, give me 1963 or give me a year, you know what I'm saying? and your marriage should get better over a period of time because you learn one another.
That's right.
You learn how to communicate with one another. You learn how to love one another. Amen. Especially when it comes to Christian relationships, you know. God, he just put the icing on the cake.
Yes.
Everything gets sweeter.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
From the inside out.
That's right.
Glory to God. Let's pray. Glory to God. Father, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
We honor you this day, God. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives and for the people's lives. We thank you because the seed of the word of God is going to fall on good ground in Jesus' name. You're healing relationships, God.
Yes.
Oh, they understanding what covenant really is, God. They know how to love, well, unconditional love. They know how to be joined as one in Jesus' name. To death do they part in Jesus' name. And Lord, and the fear of the Lord is in their relationship in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Yes.
My God, glory to God. Yes. Praise his name.
Amen.
Amen. I said, my wife is the teacher. I'm the preacher.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
I wake you up. She teach you up. Glory to God.
Praise God.
Teach you up. I got to remember. Yes. Okay.
Amen. That's all right. We're continuing to talk about God's design for marriage and. Really, pray this is being a blessing to you as we go through
it
this.
It's blessing me, I tell you.
Amen.
That.
It's always a blessing to us.
What about Camera Lady? Is it blessing you?
Amen.
Praise
all
God.
Right
amen.
Now.
That's our daughter out there.
The Amen Corner. Amen. All right, we're going on to talk about all other relationships. How do we, now that we're married, deal with all the other relationships amen. In our life or in our past? So these are things we really want to touch on, starting out with Mark 10. I know we left off with Mark 10 and 9. We're going to start with verse 7, Mark 10, 7 through 9. And I'm reading in the Message Bible. It kind of puts it in today's language. All right. So it says, Jesus said, Moses wrote this commandment only as a concession. That's the commandment or the writing of divorce to your hardened hearted ways. I can say that. Hard-hearted ways. There
Sounds
you go.
Sounds good to me, lady.
So it was a concession, meaning he made an allowance for their hard-heartedness. And then it says, in the original creation, God made male and female to be together. Because of this, a man leaves father and mother. And in marriage, he becomes one flesh with a woman, no longer two individuals, but forming new unity. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Because God created this organic union of two sexes, No one should discredit or discredit his art by cutting them apart. And you know, there is that example of really cutting away. When divorce happens, there is a cutting apart.
It's a cutting away, and there's also a tearing.
Yes, yes, you know,
of the soulish man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's so important. You got to recognize that.
Yes.
If you're going to get married, you know who you marry.
Yeah. Yeah.
You got to know who you're with.
Yes.
In your relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we always say a relationship start off with friendship and develop as a relationship.
Yes.
Start off as friends.
That is so important.
Start off as friends. I don't care if you just met. Start off as friends.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Praise God. And because once you start as a friend, you know, it's no strings attached.
That's right. That's right. Amen.
You can be yourself.
Amen. You're just free to be you.
That's right. You're free to be you. You need to be able to talk, you know, get to know one another out of honest heart.
No pressure.
No pressure whatsoever.
No pressure.
And being honest with one another where you stay in in that relationship. You don't want to push it. You know, but you just want to take your time.
Yeah. And be realistic. It's not like the movies. I like that series Pastor Paul did.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't like the movies. You know, we fantasize and we try to make it seem like, you know, it's supposed to be a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
We all have our ideas about what the perfect relationship should look like. But it's not fantasy. It's reality. It's two people who are human. They're real. They have real emotions. They have an experience that they've gone through in their life that's usually different than yours. And that has a lot to do with who they are and what makes them so unique to you.
That's right. Be careful on who you get your information from.
Mm.
Or where you get your information from.
Mm-hmm.
You get it from the movies.
Yeah.
You know,
if you start fantasizing and wanting a certain type
fantasy,
of relationship.
Just out of love book, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Get it from the Word of God.
Yeah. Romance novel, he means.
Yeah, romance.
Love book.
Whatever.
That's book, right. I like it.
If it's not from the good book, which is the Word of God.
Come on, that's a real love book.
Amen. That's a love book right there. And Paul, 1 Corinthians 13 chapter, had the whole chapter on love.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
This is a love story. What it is, the Bible,
from
just
God
a love
to
story.
Us. Yes.
God wooing his people back to him.
Amen.
His children back to him.
Amen.
And that is so. And we should be wooing our loved one back to us.
Yes.
You know, closer over the period of time. Closer and closer.
Amen.
Every year. Amen. Go to a seminar. Or every 6 months, go to a seminar to learn how, even more so, to keep the romance back into your relationship.
Yes. Yes.
And keep that friendship going on in your relationship.
Mm. Yes.
You know?
That has been an
even after you say I do.
Yes.
After you say I do, you want to keep that friendship there.
Amen.
My wife is my best friend.
Amen.
You know, she's my best friend.
Amen. Amen. I like him. I say that a lot, but I mean it. You know, we have learned from forming that friendship relationship first how important that is over the years and how that's pulled us back into good relationship with one another. Just remembering, this is my friend. I love all the things that I loved about him then. They're still there. You know, he's exactly what I look for in a man. And God actually brought all that to my mind. It would always bring me back into right relationship.
Amen. As long as our relationship is good with God,
mm-hmm.
we have a fresh relationship with each other.
Mm-hmm.
Our love grows towards God. Then it grows towards one another.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, we don't fall in love. Love is not an accident. We grow in the love of God.
Amen.
Because we love God with all our heart and all our strength and all our might. And we want God to be pleased with us. So therefore, by pursuing God, we pursue one another as well.
Amen. Amen.
You know, I don't try to change her. It's not my job to change her. I love her just the way if God doesn't change her, you know, we shouldn't try to change one another.
Yeah, absolutely.
You let God deal with each other.
Mm-hmm.
You got problems in your relationship, you go to God. Yes, you can communicate it with your mate,
mm-hmm.
but you feel like if they're not hearing you, you go to God.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all other things will be added. God will add unto your relationship.
Yeah.
What is he going to add them to? He's going to add the blessings of Abraham on you. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Glory to God. Amen. He's going to renew the right spirit in you.
Amen.
He's going to teach you how to communicate by his Holy Spirit. Teach you how to communicate one to another.
Amen.
As long as you honor him, he will honor you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Deuteronomy 28 is what I think of when he says all the blessings that God will add, you know, mm-hmm. you know, blessed everywhere you go. Mm-hmm. So understand that God intended that for you, and don't be so quick to quit when things get difficult.
Marriage takes work.
It takes work.
It takes work.
Yeah. So don't be quick to quit. That's why we talked about covenant in our last session. All right. Still talking about other relationships and how we should deal with the other relationships in our life. So we talked about how important it was to walk in covenant. Now we want to talk about leaving. What does it mean to truly leave all other relationships behind? And when we say that, we realize you're not going to leave your family. Mm-hmm. But you do have to leave their home.
That's right.
And you do leave a certain type of single lifestyle behind. Mm-hmm. You're no longer a single person, so that old singleness has to go.
That's true. That's true.
You know, and that takes a process of time as well. And then you want to sever any old relationships mm-hmm. that were, you know, whether they've been boyfriend, girlfriend, former spouse, you know, you don't want. Yeah. And with the spouse, if it was you had a divorce and you have an ex, they say ex. You know, then you want to change that. That has to be altered. You cannot be the same way you used to be. And if you don't have children.
You can't be on beck and call all the time.
That's right. They can't call you up and have you come by every time they need something.
You come fix my car. You come fix my car.
We've had some interesting conversations.
Yes, we do a lot of counseling. You know, I'm talking about marriage, Christian relationship. We do a lot of counseling and we hear a lot of things. You know, ex-wife, then you come and fix my car, and you've remarried and everything, and,
yes.
and you got to run to her to beck and call, and this she's trying to use things to draw you back in.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
what it is,
and make you feel responsible when you're no longer married.
Exactly.
Yeah. You so know? and like I said, that's why you know wholeness was so important, because we need to take care of a lot of that before we jump into a new relationship. And establish the right kind of boundaries.
Amen. You got to have boundaries in your relationship.
Absolutely.
That boundary is to guard your relationship.
Yes.
Not to smother you.
Amen.
But to guard and protect your relationship.
Now, if you have children with an ex-spouse, then you do have to have conversations. You
of
have
course.
To have a relationship. And we pray that you will have a godly relationship with them and good communication if they're open to it. You know, but by all means, that relationship has to be altered. Mm-hmm. And then any, you know, bad influences, the relationships that kind of pull you, you know, back into that single mindset. A lot of people, they get married, but they still want to hang around some of the same single friends that do some of the things that they shouldn't be doing. Like they're not living, you know, whole and pure in their sexual relationship. So you don't need to be as a married person around that all the time.
That's right.
You know, that doesn't mean you have to completely drop the relationship, but those who are not in agreement with your new marriage, drop them.
And cut them up.
Cut them off.
Cut them off. No, not cut them, cut them, but
cut it off. Amen. Cut it off. Because you don't need that conflict.
You don't want nothing to be pulling you away from your relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You want something to be building your relationship up.
Amen.
You know, so we tell a lot of a married couple, get married friends.
Yes, married couple
You can keep
friends.
Some single friends, yes, but the thing is, you can't do as they do. They can go in and out when they get ready. But when you try to go out, your wife going to say, oh, your husband going to say, what time are you going to be back?
Hello.
They have the right to do that.
Yes.
Yes, look at me. They have the right to do that.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
They got papers on you.
Yes. I used to use that as a joke every now and then. I got papers on you.
That's right. They have right there. You're no longer single no more.
Amen.
And yeah, we always say you can't live a single lifestyle in a marriage household.
It doesn't work.
No, it doesn't work.
Causes all kind of conflict.
Division.
Yes.
It's too much selfishness.
Yes. Yes, and that usually comes from not wanting to change anything. You know, today's philosophy is that I don't have to change anything. You know, we get married and I don't have to change anything for you. That's not real.
That's not real.
That is not real. That is a
fantasy.
You gotta
change your single lifestyle.
That's right.
That's changing. That's what you gotta do.
Number one, you're supposed to change your address.
There you go.
There's so many things that happen to change. You're changing your name 9 times out of 10. Some of the people are bucking against that too. Mm-hmm. You're changing your lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
Because now, you know, you're no longer
single. Your income is changing.
Your income changes. There's a lot of change that comes along with marriage. You know, and so
your bills change.
Yes. Two do not live as cheaply as one.
No.
And so a lot of things do change, but understand change should be a good thing for those who are walking in the right relationship with one another. It should be a change for the better.
Mm-hmm.
You're increasing. You know, one of the things we talk about is how important it is to allow yourself to, you know, experience another person's viewpoint.
That's right.
You know, it's not an opposition to you for someone to have a difference of opinion. Does that mean that, you know, everything comes to an end because we have a difference Mm-mm. of opinion? No. I mean, we're just learning from each other how each other thinks.
I learned so many things from my wife. I'm telling you. The Lord showed me how to love through her, you know. And she learned a lot of faith from me. I learned how to the love walk from her.
Amen.
And you know, the Bible says it's faith working by love.
Yes.
You know, and it's so important to allow yourself to be, you know, build up one another, build one another up in Jesus' name.
That's right.
And begin to just confess the word of God over their lives, you know. Watch what you're saying to them.
Yes.
Because the Bible says death and life is in the power of the tongue. I don't say anything wrong to my wife because I don't want to see anything wrong happen to her.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
death and life is in the power of God.
That's right. He doesn't speak negative things over me.
No.
Is what he's
no.
saying. And I don't speak negative words over him.
Mm-hmm.
And because those words are seeds.
Yeah, those are seeds.
They're very powerful. God created us to in his image. And by doing that, he gave us the ability to create with our words.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't realize we're having what we say a lot over each other. So
exactly.
Be careful what words you choose.
Mm-hmm. Jesus
Amen.
Christ is our priest of your confession.
That's right.
The confession
Amen.
Of your faith.
Amen. And then we want to talk about, you know, now that we've entered into this relationship, the changes that will have to be made. You know, what is our relationship with our parents like? Is that going to be, how are we going to change that? What? Some of us aren't close to parents.
No. And
you know,
some of us are.
And some are. He's talking about me. And so, because it's a huge difference. Like, our testimony is, Carl was, you know, he didn't have that real tight-knit type of family relationship, but I did. And, you know, my parents, they wanted to see me all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my dad was our pastor. He was a minister in our church. And, you know, I'm the pastor's daughter, so you can just imagine the expectations.
We were assistant pastors.
Then we became assistant pastors mm-hmm. after we were married. So it was they were very much a part of our lives.
Yeah.
In every sense of the word. And he was literally surrounded by my family.
Yes.
I had, and I never thought about this really all that much, but my brother was in one building, my sister in another, my mom and dad in the other, and then we were
New
in
New York.
This is New York. We're from New York. And so it was just amazing. He was surrounded.
Yep.
And I never gave it another thought, really.
Well, you lived under that, so, you know, you really didn't
think about it. I was comfortable with it. Yeah. I was my family. Of course I was comfortable with it.
Amen.
And so, and my mom, if she had her way, I'd be over every single day.
7 days a week, 24 hours a day.
So he had to really get used to that because mm-hmm. his family was never, you know, all over each other, mm-hmm. you know. Always there. So it was a big dynamic, a different dynamic for each other.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a challenge for us to learn how to bring balance to that. I had to learn how to alter that relationship. And he had to learn how to give a little bit on that mm-hmm. as well, because he needed to see that it was okay for some things to be close, but just there had to be boundaries. And so we had to learn how to draw some healthy boundaries.
Exactly. We're not talking about disrespecting your parents.
That's right.
No, I don't believe that. How old you get, you know, Ephesians 6 chapter said, children, obey your parents and love, for it is right. Honor thy father and thy mother.
That's right.
It's the first commandment with promise.
There's a promise. Absolutely.
Amen. The Bible speaks about long life.
That's right.
You know?
Amen.
And the thing is, you're the thing, but you have to put boundaries in your relationship.
Yeah.
Your parents is not there to dictate to you, you know, like they did when you were the child.
That's right.
You got to be weaned from them.
Mm.
They dare to be mentors to you, to give you right advice.
Yes.
Not to rule you.
Amen.
You know?
Yes.
Because you can't, you got to go through that cleaving process
That's
in your
right.
relationship.
Amen.
Which, amen.
Amen.
Amen. And they got to, they can't just come over when they get ready. They should really phone before they come. Isn't
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we've heard some interesting stories
yes,
about
we
that
have.
As well.
Yeah.
And then parents have to learn how to release their children.
How to release them.
Let them become responsible for themselves. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, you know. That's happened well before you get married, but even if it hasn't, like in my case, it hadn't. I mean, I was independent to a degree, but I was still living at home. So it was really hard for them to release me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so it, and I was the last one, I was the baby.
Mm-hmm.
So that was also made it somewhat difficult for them to see me as a woman and an adult. So those are transitions that you need to start making with your parents if you haven't already done that. And then those of you who are parents, you need to start releasing your children so that they can experience their independence once they are ready to make this step into marriage.
And man, if you're getting ready to get married, okay, and you're still living with your parents, my suggestion for you is to move out and learn how to pay bills on your own.
That's right.
You know, learn how to pay bills, how to begin to, you know, because you, once you get married, you want to bring your spouse to your place, not to your parents' place. Because that is not your place. That's your parents' place.
That's right. They dictate still, no
that's
matter
right.
how old you are.
That's right.
You've
got to obey their rules and regulations in their household.
That's right.
So get your own and live on your own for about 6 months and what have you, you know.
Amen.
You know, before you say I do.
That's right.
You know?
That's right. Build your own way. And then ask your parents, you know, this is prior to marriage. Ask your parents how they feel about your potential mate.
Your potential mate, yeah.
You know,
find
out what
they
like.
You want their blessings.
Like about them. Absolutely. You want their blessing. You want to see, you know, is there something they're seeing that you're not seeing? If they love you, and we know everybody doesn't have the same type of
mm-hmm.
family dynamic, you know, mm-hmm. where they have a good relationship with parents. But if you have parents that love you, then they're going to want the best for you. So you need to listen to what they have to say, find out what they're seeing, so that they can speak a blessing over your marriage relationship. Amen. And then ask, find out about your friends. Ask your friends, how do they like your mate? Do, you know, is there something that they see? And then if there's friends that are kind of, you know, not in agreement with this relationship for the wrong reasons, then you need to release them.
Some friends are jealous of you.
Yeah. We didn't realize there would be any jealousy after mm-hmm. we were married, but there actually was some. And it was a complete surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Complete surprise to us. So understand things like that can happen. Some of the friendships that you used to have may have to change.
Mm-hmm.
And so be willing to do that. You know, don't keep a friendship that's hurting your relationship.
That's right.
With your spouse. And when we say that, we mean a friend that's actually, you know, pulling you away from walking in unity with your spouse.
They're trying to sabotage your relationship.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then we've had change, you know, there were friendships where, you know, that person's only friends with the spouse, and they don't want to be friends with, you know, your mate.
Your new mate.
Then that's not a good friend.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a good friend. They should be able to accept your spouse as well. That doesn't mean you're all going to want to hang out and be buddies. But, you know, if they can't accept your spouse, then they're not the right kind of relationship.
Exactly. It's time to have friends that will respect your relationship.
Absolutely.
And if they don't respect your relationship, they're not your friend.
That's the truth of it.
Because
they need
friend.
To honor you and honor your choice.
Because if they don't respect your relationship, they don't respect you.
Amen. Amen. And you need to be willing to make those changes. Are you willing? You think about this. Are you willing to change and alter relationships with family or friends? And if you're not, if you feel like this person is not, you know, you don't feel safe or comfortable enough to make adjustments, then they probably shouldn't be the mate that you marry.
Sure.
You know, if you believe your parents have a valid reason why this isn't a healthy relationship, be willing to break it off if you realize they're right.
That's right.
They're right. Yeah. There's something wrong here.
Now, if your parents say saying that this is not the right person, it's good to ask them why.
Yeah, ask them why. Find out what they're seeing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's like if some racial tension, you know, that's not according to the word of God.
Yeah.
All right. And that's a long message right there to go through.
Because
We've seen that.
But you also even have to ask yourself, even in the instance where there's a racial discrimination, that's part of the reasoning. Am I willing to release my family to be with this person?
That's right.
Because you are signing on, according to the word of God, for a lifetime commitment. So are you willing to release that relationship with your family to be with this person?
Mm-hmm.
So you need to think about that as well, because we've been on the other side of that and we've seen how painful that can be.
It can really be
painful. That doesn't mean it's justified for a person not to accept your potential mate just because they're of a different race. But it is something you need to consider, because you're making a commitment.
That's right.
And you cannot have your parents sabotaging your relationship after the fact.
That's right.
Just to keep in relationship with them.
Right.
You know, we've even had some where the one spouse is like being pulled by their family. They go with family and they leave their spouse at home. Are you kidding?
No.
The word of God says the two shall be one.
That's right.
So you got to think about that.
That's right.
So be willing to make those adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, we're already running out of time.
We're running out of time. I didn't know that.
That went real quick.
Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen. So again, we want to bring your attention to our book, and we want you to know that the Lord really put this book on our heart.
Yeah.
It was as the result of teaching on marriage, both through our premarital classes. And also
11 years, right? 10, 11 years.
10
right?
years. It was over 10 years, mm-hmm. almost 11. And really just knowing that in the spirit, God really wanted us to put this down on paper.
This is our passion here.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
We want to see marriage be made whole.
Amen.
You know.
Amen. So pick up your copy. It's Before and After Biblical Principles for a Successful Marriage. It's for singles. It's for couples. It's for Christian counselors. We believe it'll be a true blessing in your life. Praise God. You can also contact us through our website, higherlifeoutreach.org. And then if you'd like to become a partner with us, you can start being a partner by your monthly donation of $20 or more. We'll send you out our newsletter. And for those of you who would partner at $100 or more, we'll send you a free copy of the book as well as our newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
You can contact us also at, again, at higherlifeoutreach.org. You can also email us through the website, and our address is 1215 East Kenosha Street, Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, 74012. We'd love to hear from you, so please email us, contact us. You can call us, 918-806-6734. We'd love to hear from you.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you right now for
thank
the Holy
Father.
Spirit of God and the people that heard us, God, those that seen us, God, in Jesus' name. Your seed of the word has fell on good ground. Lord, you're working on the family, God, in Jesus' name. You're making us whole. We believe you, and
in
so
Jesus
shall we prosper
name.
In Jesus' name. And always remember, so then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
God bless you.
Amen. Glory to God.